Bonjour, mesdames et messieurs. Good afternoon. Welcome to you all. It's absolutely delightful to see how many people have turned out for this first ever security talk sponsored by ADGA, and we hope it'll be the first of many. Alors, merci à tous d'être parmi nous. It demonstrates, quite frankly, the interest that you have in this subject, of course, but it also indicates the fact that you're committed to learning more about this and hopefully learning some of the things that our very distinguished panelists are going to tell us today. Now, I wish a very fond welcome to you all, of course, but I'd also like to acknowledge the fact that we have some very distinguished panelists, as I mentioned. Thank you to our MC, by the way, for opening up this afternoon. But thank you to Dick Fadden, Tyson McCauley, and Ray Boisvert for joining us this afternoon. And they are going to help us frame the discussion that we would like to have this afternoon, and also hopefully give us some questions and answers that will guide us in what we would like to explore in this very difficult issue of global security in the Internet of Things, everything, and perhaps even quantum computing. Our goal this afternoon is to have a frank and open exchange, by the way. It's not just to have them present to you, but also to take questions from the floor, look at the things that are of significant interest to you, and hopefully give you some answers. And if not, help us to develop those answers to the questions, and I'm sure they'll be probing on your part. C'est aussi quelque chose qui nous est très cher à la suite du Forum international de Halifax, où nous avons eu le grand privilège d'assister à plusieurs de nous ont été à Halifax. And it gave us a chance to look at what global security is all about, looking at a broad range of nations. Halifax had 70 nations there. The discussions dominated by global security, but more importantly, what I just mentioned, global insecurity. And that not just from technological improvements and technological change, but also from the dynamics of changing political structures and things of that nature. So what we're going to do today is try and follow on with that a little bit. Dick Fadden was there. He was able to interact in the same way as many of us were with the very prominent folks that were at Halifax. And today we'd like to sort of extend that through the presentations that they're going to give you, focusing in on things like the changing political landscape, which I mentioned, which is very real today, especially with the elections that we've seen recently and the things that are occurring on a global scale at the moment. The explosion of the global data exchange, and again, that will be discussed in some depth by our panelists. The transformation of intelligence and the transformation of data sharing, what that means to situational awareness, what it means to practitioners and what they have to deal with in that respect. Cybersecurity, of course, which is one of our themes, and the space connection that brings with it. And of course, the Internet of Things, everything, and quantum computing. And what does all that do to change our way of life and how we act on a day-to-day basis, both at home and abroad? Now, those kinds of things will be acknowledged and hopefully dealt with folks like you and me and the many panelists that we have here, but the experts that are out there. And so this is an opportunity to share those views and to share the information that all of us have been able to glean and to develop from looking at these types of issues over time. Finally, for me, this is a very significant changing landscape, and for me, it's very personal. If I look back at my early days as a young Voodoo pilot, now I'm dating myself going back to the early 1970s, but to me, getting into the Voodoo after having had my flying training on the Tudor and the T-33 was a revolution for me. It was a technological change that I had not factored in. And I had things as technologically advanced in those days as a floating steering dot to guide me to weapons release. And to me, that was pretty special. And it could be done through the autopilot if you needed it to. And so that's the kind of technology that we saw back then. Today, a pilot, fighter aircraft, bomber, even helicopters at the moment, he or she is no longer just someone who takes advantage of the technology that's around him or her, but is now part of that whole technology change. With the changes in software, the sensor systems that are on board many of the modern aircraft today, the way that information is shared, exchanged, analyzed, fused, and then fed back to all the agencies that need it, is a huge change in technology. So for me, that becomes personal. And at the same time, having had the great privilege and opportunity to see how things go from a diplomatic, political, military sense, both at the national and international levels, I'm very conscious of the fact that this type of change that we're seeing, the technological evolution that comes with something like the Internet of Everything, has a huge impact on life, and it has a huge impact on the way we do business. And so for that very reason, this is something that I know many of you in this room have already determined as well, but for me, becomes that much more important as we look and go downstream. Alors, merci à tous d'être parmi nous cet après-midi. I would like to acknowledge the fact that the CEO of ADGA, Madame Françoise Gagnon, is with us this afternoon. Thank you for joining us for this discussion, Fran. And we know that many of you will join us for the Christmas reception afterwards, and we look forward to that as well.
It's a real pleasure to be here. I always enjoy talking and discussing these topics. Although I must admit that my first reaction when I got into the hall is that I need to get a new photo. It looks like I'm a member of the Politburo. So let me start by saying that my topic is National Security 2.0. When I talk national security, I think I'm using a modern definition. I think it's very difficult in this day and age to talk about security policy or defense policy or foreign policy in isolation. And I think we do so at our own risk. And indeed, I think you have to integrate into that some elements of international development policy and even some elements of international economic policy. So when I think or talk national security, I'm using a very broad definition. When I was trying to think about what I would say today, I started off by going through a list of things that were going badly in the world. And I talked about these with my wife a little bit, and she said, you know, you're going to have to be careful because you're beginning to make Darth Vader look like an uplifting sort of guy. So I've changed it a little bit, and what I've tried to do is to develop 10 characteristics of the current environment, which I think have an impact on a whole bunch of other things. So the first one is, I don't think we're facing an existential threat. And even for those of us who work in national security, I think we have to admit this is a good thing. Not risking the planet being blown up is a good thing. But from a tactical or a practical perspective, I think there's a downside to that, which is that facing no threat at that level, many people don't like to think about threats at all. It makes it increasingly difficult for governments and democracies to marshal arguments, resources, people, and ideas. You know, if you think back of what it was like during the Cold War, it wasn't very hard to get people excited about what could happen. Today, if you look at any number of polls that are conducted in Canada in particular, you will find that people, you know, 6 to 8 weeks after an event, a terrorist event, for example, we revert to our standard position of, well, you know, we're pretty safe. We've got three oceans in the United States. Don't bug me. Go away. So no existential threat is a very good thing, but it does make it difficult in democracies to marshal people to think about threats. The second thing I wanted to mention was, in the absence of that kind of threat, and actually the absence of a lot of traditional warfare, we don't know what winning is anymore. I mean, we're facing a terrorist threat, we're facing cyber warfare, cyber criminality. Espionage in Canada is at the same level now that it was at the time of the Cold War. So when do we decide that we've been successful in dealing with all these threats and adversaries? And I don't think as a country or even the West has come to a conclusion. And if you can't figure out what you're trying to get to, again, it's very difficult to marshal people to support you in doing things. And again, I think that's particularly risky in Canada because we're not inclined that way. You know, the United States has no choice. The United Kingdom has a centuries-old tradition of worrying about the safety of the state. We just don't have that. So, you know, you ask the average Canadian, you know, what are we doing in Syria and Iraq? And you get answers, you know, ranging from this end to that end of the spectrum. But it does complicate program and policy development when you really don't know what a success will be. The third point I'd like to make is that threats are coming from multiple sources. Unlike the Cold War, where they were basically state-based, a number of states, and they were really nasty. But today you have states, you have terrorist groups, you have what I call cyber NGOs, you have any number of sources for threats. But the real change that I think that we've had to absorb over the last little while is that the threats are coming from external sources and from internal sources. And I'll come back to this. But dealing with threats from within a particular country is one hell of a lot more complicated than dealing with bad guys 4,000 or 5,000 or 6,000 kilometers away. The Constitution applies, values are applied differently, people feel threatened in a different way. So I'd argue that one of the real characteristics of this era in the National Security Forum is the threats come from everywhere, internally and externally. And the tools that we have to deal with them are different. The people that we have to deal with them, I think, to some degree, should be different. And certainly the laws that apply and how we deal with them are very, very different. So it's one element that I think that complicates the management of national security quite significantly. The other big change that I would mention is that the number of targets are much broader. You know, in the good old days of the Cold War, you were directing it, you know, the Warsaw Pact was directing it against the West. Espionage efforts were basically directed against members of the public service and the military, and it was fairly clear. Today, it can be literally anybody. It could be my son, your daughter, those who are particularly involved in cybercrime will tell you that about $1 trillion in IP is stolen every year. So the private sector is as much affected by this as our governments and individuals. So this too significantly complicates the environment. The fourth point I wanted to mention was the range of tools used by our adversaries is much broader than has been the case in the past. You have the tools of traditional warfare. You have the IEDs that we all learned about more than we wanted to, principally from Afghanistan. We have cyber attacks, we have freedom fighters, we have suicide bombers, we have drones, we have the risks from space, and we have technology that's moving so quickly that it's very difficult for everybody, including experts, to keep track of what's going on. But I guess basically what this does in practical terms is it creates what I believe the military call new domains. And that's something that's important because international law doesn't necessarily apply equally and in the same way to all the domains that you may be dealing with. And I guess the other argument that I'd like to make that we haven't quite come to grips with in terms of the environment that we're dealing with for national security is we're really fighting two wars. One is the traditional war of, I call it whack-a-mole. That's what we're doing in Syria and Iraq. We're doing it in other parts of the world as well. There's a physical threat and we try and deal with it, sometimes more, sometimes less effectively. But generally speaking, we're at least containing that threat at great cost, but we are containing it, we being the West. But the one where I think we're losing is the threat against people's minds. And I think the threats are equally important and they should be dealt with as much enthusiasm and dedication, but not necessarily entirely from the same people, by the same people. So we can succeed in whacking the moles everywhere on the planet if we want, but every time we do that, we're making more enemies in one, or adversaries if you want to be more neutral. The use of the internet, the use of the dark web in order to generate supporters for people who are against, you know, the so-called Western way of life. We are not winning that battle, and unless we find a way of at least containing that threat, I would argue it's going to have an impact on everything else that that we do. Fifthly, I'd like to mention what I think is a bit of a mix in the motivation on the part of our adversaries. Again, in the old days, it was simple. The Warsaw Pact, the Soviet Union, you didn't have to be a rocket scientist or a pilot like Ray to figure out what they were all about. You could sit down, read an article, and it was fairly straightforward. You may not have liked it, but it was fairly straightforward. So today we have a couple of states, Russia comes to mind, where the preservation of the territory and the expansion of the territory is a prime motivation, and there are a few others who think in those terms. But I'd argue that they are, relatively speaking, a small part of the motivation. They provide a small part of the motivation that our adversaries may have. A lot of it is ideology, and you can include religion in ideology or not, but that's much more difficult to deal with because people in those categories tend to be fanatics. I was trying to think the other day when I was talking to another group about how I could try and characterize the fanaticism that we're facing against Daesh. And the only comparison that I could think of that everybody would, you know, understand is the latter-day Nazis, where they literally had to be killed in order to take them out of the battle. And some of the people who are, you know, Daesh adherents are perfectly happy to die, and we're going to have to kill some of them in order to deal with the problem. So this level of fanaticism is not something I think that the planet has had to deal with for some time. I think the last time that, you know, historians will tell you this was the case was during the Middle Ages, where we in the West were just as fanatical then as our adversaries are today. The other difference that I think is important to note is the significant increase in the number, the amounts, whatever, of ungoverned and partially governed states. You know, at the time the Treaty of Westphalia was signed, you know, 4 or 5 centuries ago, it was generally recognized that every piece of earth on the planet had to have a government that was organized and had a series of characteristics. And by and large, with a couple of exceptions, that's been the case for some time now. I'd like to suggest that one of our problems today is that the increasing number of ungoverned spaces. You know, parts of Syria, parts of Iraq, parts of Somalia, parts of Sudan, parts of Libya. Probably parts still today of Pakistan and possibly Afghanistan. They all seem a long ways away, and why should we worry about them? But all of them allow the gathering together of people who mean a great deal of harm. And since the international arms sales movement is as robust now as it ever been, it doesn't matter how far you are, you can cause a great deal of trouble. And if we accept the basic premise that if we're going to protect ourselves, we have to push out our defenses, the fact that, you know, people are beginning, Daesh now has a province in Libya, there's a lot of weaponry left over from the Gaddafi days, so they're quite happy. And Libya, if you look at a map, you'll see is not all that far from Europe. So you can understand why our British or French or Italian colleagues are very, very concerned about what may happen. And it goes back to my earlier point, we're going to, you know, we may well succeed in playing whack-a-mole in Syria and Iraq, but that's just the beginning. You know, a lot of people have already moved to Libya. There are Daesh groups in, I think, 9 provinces now. So ungoverned space is, I think, a major problem for all of us in a way that we really haven't come to grips with. The almost last one of my comments is, from the West's perspective, we are singularly ill-equipped to deal with long-term problems. And I don't mean just politicians who suffer from this because of, you know, they have to get reelected. But most of the problems that I've either described or that I've implied are problems that are not going to be solved in 4 or 5 years. And in a democracy, to convince people that you have to keep going for 15 years when there's no immediate and direct threat is nigh on impossible. I think that's one of the biggest challenges today in national security, and we haven't found a way to deal with it. You know, as a practical example, there are probably people in this room who served in Afghanistan. And we made a fair bit of progress in Afghanistan when we, the coalition, were there. And now it's slowly reverting to what it was before. Yes, progress has been made on a number of fronts, but there are large parts of Afghanistan now that fall, I think, within the definition of ungoverned spaces, and that's what started this problem in the first place. And, you know, I could think of a couple of other examples. Another point I'd like to mention is we're not sure in what G category the world is in anymore. Are we in a G2, a G0, where the United States is all things to all people? Are we in a G question mark? Now, that may seem like I'm trying to be funny, but I think it's actually quite important because the leadership of all of this is very, very important. And the fact that we don't have a clear answer to what category of G world we're living in significantly increases uncertainty in virtually every part of the planet. Uncertainty breeds problems, it breeds people who want to cause trouble. This is my way of saying in a diplomatic way, we have a problem with the United States. The United States has more physical power than you can shout at, but you gotta want to use it, you gotta be willing to use it, you have to be willing to use it in a sustained way. And everybody's been making a business these days of accusing Mr. Trump of being, you know, the worst thing since the Black Plague. And for some of these things, he may be. But I would remind us all that Mr. Obama was very restrained in his use of United States military force. And it's not only because he didn't want to use it, it's because the United States population ain't there. And in a democracy, you can't fight a war, or you can't fight one for very long. So this G-level, who runs the world, who's in a leadership position, I think is not clear, and it significantly increases uncertainty. Same with the dealings with the Russian Federation and the PRC. My one feeble attempt at a soundbite is national security is not national anymore. You can't deal with this issue without dealing with it internationally. I think that's self-evident. But it's equally evident that national governments alone can't deal with it. In Canada, we need to involve the provinces, the municipalities, civil society, communities. It's the only way we're going to deal with that battle of the minds that I was talking about. And we're not quite used to the idea here that civil society and the provinces might have a role in dealing with national security. And I think it's not going to work until we find a way of doing that. So my last point is, and I think it's one of the more important ones, which is that everything is connected to everything else. There was a time when you could develop a policy in a particular area, and with a little bit of luck, you could get away without worrying about 15 other things. But what I was trying to illustrate through my 8 or 9 points was none is a standalone. None is in a box. And you know, you have governments supporting cyber terrorism. You have governments supporting cyber crime. You have criminal groups doing some of the same thing. I could keep going. But the point is, we have to develop, I think, a holistic approach to deal with national security matters. I'm not sure we're doing it all as effectively as we could. All of this, of course, has the practical effect of immensely complicating decision making. And the West is already at a disadvantage because we usually operate in coalitions and it takes time. Putin, on the other hand, can decide to invade Crimea in a 12-hour period. It's one of the real problems, I think, that the West has. So let me stop there, except to say that I've focused on the negative here. It's almost as if I were the Auditor General. Just to pick a couple of points, you know, Canada and North America is relatively safe, you know, compared to large parts of the rest of the planet. There is a greater risk in Canada, I think, of being electrocuted in a bathtub than of being killed by terrorism. China today is no democracy, no grand cadeau, as they say in French, but it's a much nicer place for a whole variety of perspective than it was under Mao. Poverty has gone down tremendously on the planet. So there are good stories. The bad news is that most of the short term and the immediate issues bring bad news. And what I've tried to suggest is that we need to be as imaginative as we can and to start making linkages between all of them. And before I get the hook from David, I will stop talking. Thank you for listening.
This is a topic where certainly you can be accused of being Darth Vader. For sure. I've given a number of talks, and often it comes down to, you know, you've scared the hell out of me. What do we do about this now? So rather than sort of get to what's really bad, I'd like to start by saying that I operate as an advisor for a number of startups in Canada. And there's tremendous things happening in Canada when it comes to cybersecurity and IoT solutions. So we're certainly in a very positive space when it comes to addressing the emerging problems. And I'll talk about what some of those solutions look like over the course of my 10 minutes. But there's a but. The but being that as Canadians and technology, this being Chatham House rules, I'll say it out loud, we tend to not adopt our own technologies. So a lot of these companies are forced to look south of the border or elsewhere to where they're spending money in places like smart cities on smart transportation to try and get what they need to get off the ground. So I would ask the audience, to the extent that you have an opportunity, to look at Canadian technologies and do so and invest in them, because we've got some great stuff here. And my perspective is very much international. I spent the last 5 years working in just about every continent on security challenges and issues. Many of these challenges and issues focused around IoT. So the stuff I'm going to talk about now is, I'd say, ubiquitous sorts of problems. And the first one is that if you remember that adage, you can have it good, fast, or cheap. Well, the IoT is fast and cheap. And it doesn't matter whether it's industrial IoT or whether it's consumer IoT. It's fast and it's cheap. And the things that we're seeing in the internet right now are a result of this rush to get to market very quick with the minimum amount of cost. And it doesn't matter if it's an industrial control unit or closed circuit TV or a home router. And this is not going to change because the IoT is about more efficiency and it's about more effectiveness and it's about driving down costs. And it is very difficult to look for good when it comes to the IoT. And this means that the security problems that we're facing now are escalating. And the other thing about the IoT is that we cross a tipping point or a watershed very, very quickly. We don't see these things coming. An example, a great example, is the Mirai botnet that took over DVRs and cameras on the net. And literally, denial of service attacks on the internet have been escalating slowly and slowly, and we're talking about a quarter terabit, and it's looking big and bad. And then overnight, we pop through 1 terabit of DDoS attacks, overnight, because of an IoT vulnerability. So we didn't expect this. We expected it to continue at a relatively predictable rate, and it didn't happen. So we hit a tipping point, and things just go south really quickly. Another thing about the IoT is that, to the best of my knowledge, nobody has died yet in a very attributable manner because of the IoT. So there are vulnerabilities in pacemakers, in security cameras, in door locks, et cetera, but no one has been conclusively linked to a death around IoT. What we have seen, though, are power grids, which have been taken down. And if you know anything about interdependencies and critical infrastructures, when you take down a critical infrastructure, almost as a direct result, people are harmed and fatalities occur, for instance, because ambulances don't get dispatched in time. Or maybe a water purification system fails long enough for pathogens to get in, and some people get sick, and the old and the weak die. In the IoT, I would say any day now, unfortunately, we're going to hit that tipping point where people are going to die. And we should be prepared to deal with it, whether from a policy perspective or from a management perspective. This is coming. And I don't know when. You know, it could happen any day now. It might be 10 years from now. But when it happens, it's going to be sudden. It's not going to be a gradual transition. So some of the solutions, what are the sorts of things that we can expect from the IoT security people? And what are their challenges? One of the big challenges right now at a management level is the lack of any type of standard. I work within the ISO and the ITUT, and we're about 3.5 years into developing IoT security standards and reference designs, but they're not coming quickly. And as a result, there's a lot of ad hocery around what a secure IoT system should look like. There are some pieces of information being released. For instance, the Industrial Internet Consortium just released some guidance around IoT security. This is a good start for sure. But for lack of having standards around IoT security, we are going to see things like trade barriers crop up around it, because it's very simple to say you can't import if your IoT doesn't meet this type of standard. But what we're also going to see is litigation. The American Bar Association is warming up on this topic right now. And they know that there are no standards. There are very few laws. And without standards, you can't claim due care. You don't really have a defense for negligence when no one can tell you what a well-designed system should look like. So they're on the borders. They're waiting for things to happen. We have opportunists who are already taking advantage of the fears around IoT to do things like short the capital markets. There was a case earlier this year where someone released a detailed explanation of a vulnerability in pacemakers from a maker called St. Jude's. They teamed up with an equities firm to short the publicly listed shares of St. Jude's, and then collect on the drop in the market. There's no law or standards for St. Jude to immediately argue that they had applied to protect themselves against these types of financial threats or enterprise-level threats. So standards is an area where we need some help. We need to get something out there so that there's guidance for these users, for the implementers, for the integrators, for the product companies. Another area where we're really facing an uphill climb, I'd say, is in the area of skills. And everybody in this room has probably encountered the lack of cybersecurity skills. This is an ongoing issue. It's hard to say why it is such a problem. You know, I have a 15-year-old son, and I can't get him interested in anything except apps and games, and it kills me. I go to school boards, and we'll talk about things like network security courses. And they will tell me that, yeah, you know, the first year there was the class was full, and now we've had to cancel the class on networking security because of lack of interest or lack of enrollment. You know, they want to be the Uber of basket weaving or donut hole making or something like that. And we don't have the right people going in there. So what does this mean to us? Solutions are going to revolve around automation. The force and velocity of the IoT is not going to allow us to apply conventional security. We need more automation. And in turn, that is going to drive things like machine learning and to a certain extent artificial intelligence as a requirement to manage the security in the IoT because we don't have enough people. I think you're also going to see that conventional security has reached the point of diminishing returns. And when I say conventional, I mean firewalls and IPS and security information event management systems that we've been investing in for the last 10, 15, 20 years. And some very large companies have grown up around these technologies. But these technologies are increasingly relying on brute force in a way that just doesn't scale when you have billions and billions of devices creating terabits and terabits of data on a daily or even an hourly basis. Because they're sifting through network streams for millions of signatures or looking on for reputations on tens of thousands of different IP addresses. And when you're in the IoT, some of the security properties of the network flip on their head. We all grew up with confidentiality, availability, integrity in that order. But in the IoT, there's a much more of an industrial context that's more about availability, integrity, and confidentiality last. And even as security people, if we disagree with that, that's what the people want. And that's a hallmark of the IoT being fast and cheap. To deal with this amount of data is going to require automation. It's also going to leave firewalls and IPS and SIEM standing still. So we need more elegant solutions to that that work at the terabit level, that work at massively scaled environments the way we don't now. Again, there's hope. There are companies that are looking at this, and they're not using signatures. The world of signatures, other people have said this before me, increasingly it's becoming irrelevant because of the form of the threats, and the IoT is going to accelerate that process again. So we need better solutions that don't necessarily rely on these brute force approaches to trying to sift massive mountains of data looking for anomalies because, again, that is going to be very, very unscalable. I mentioned artificial intelligence, and the reason I'd like to dig just a bit deeper into that is because I think that there's a ton of money going into it right now. I mean, I know personally of about 15 organizations that have got venture capital for doing AI-based security, promising, you know, very hot, very au courant. But at the same time, there's a real Achilles heel when it comes to artificial intelligence, or more appropriately, machine learning in this context, is that it doesn't know what it doesn't know. It has the same vulnerabilities or the same biases or the same blind spots as the people that tend to teach it. And it then takes whatever you teach it and scales it dramatically because of the automation. So if you get people teaching it how to do security in an automated manner to protect IoT infrastructure, and those people, for instance, are IT security people, not industrial control security people, and they teach it a bias, and that bias will scale out dramatically and becomes a vulnerability. And that's the point. In AI, to the extent that we want to use it for security going forward in the future, a bias is vulnerability. And we don't have standards to try and regulate, and I don't mean this in a government context, I mean in like an industrial development context, how to teach an AI in a manner that avoids bias or minimizes bias in the system. And many of the analytics programs that are out there now, if you ask them, they'll tell you that below the covers they're using AI or machine learning techniques, and this is going to become more and more prominent. Again, something for us to address. Standards can be part of that. But in the end, asking the right questions as security managers is probably going to be the line of last defense. because standard or not, it's questions you as senior managers ask to your suppliers. And the supply chain, and this will be my last slide, Dave. The supply chain in the IoT, because of this good or fast, cheap mentality, is terrible, frankly. The big botnet attacks that we've seen was because of supply chain vulnerabilities. Another good example that would be more meaningful to everybody here was Deutsche Telekom, I think it was 2 days ago, had millions of their home gateway routers compromised. And it was because there was a vulnerability in these gateway routers that was replicated by the manufacturer many, many, many times. And as a telco, if you lose control of your gateway routers, you've lost control not only for your consumers, but for many of your SMB customers, branches, including things like fire stations, ambulance stations, water control stations that are relying on these gateway devices. So they're in the process of trying to flash and do emergency administration across their critical infrastructure in Germany right now. That type of vulnerability very much is exacerbated by the fact that so much of their infrastructure and response is IP-based. They've become IoT devices. So supply chain management, which was really a very unsexy type of occupation, is going to take on a new criticality in the IoT as well. At that point, I'll stop with the Darth Vader imitation.
Whether it be the UK's negotiations with China or the US, I think there have been some measurable successes, especially, and that's been confirmed by a number of subject matter experts, that there's been a reduction. Now, we have leverage with China that we do not have with Russia for a number of reasons, trade being number one. However, I think there's space for that. And I think part of the problem is that our diplomatic establishment is not focused on this issue. We have a very tiny global affairs group who works in that area. Very capable, I know a few of them, very honest, earnest, and engaged, but the level of resourcing is very, very small. The government must look at this issue, the issue of the integrity of our networks, the issue of cybersecurity, which affects everything from our future prosperity to our national security to the privacy of individuals, has to be on par with climate change, with global migration, with international trade, and so on. But of course it's not. It still remains a very, very low priority. The new sort of era of law enforcement, yes, we've had some indictments. Some feel that they're a little bit of political theater. I believe they're very useful. The indictment of the five PLA officers have had, I think, some effect. The same way, I think of an example back in 2003, when the Imam of Milan was rendered by American CIA agents and the assistance of the Italian SISMI organization. Indictments followed. I think there was 24 indictments in total and a number of convictions, many of course, in absentia. And of course, I think, from my professional experience, that altered the way some countries looked at rendition and looked at the way they were practicing that type of capture and interrogation approach. So I think that type of that sort of approach is certainly one that has value, and I think it's been validated time and time again. More importantly, though, I think we have to look at MLATs. I think these mutual legal assistance treaties are a critical part of the game. If you look at the more recent arrest of an Eastern European, and I believe it was in Hungary, involving the FBI and others, that was a very complex law enforcement piece that in future will require much more sophisticated styled MLATs that are targeting, again, the main characteristic or the main topic, which is cyber. So finally, I'll stop there on that particular issue, and I'll shift over to the defend part. Defending is a tough trick. It's a very difficult time in an age of, as Tyson was saying, we probably can no longer reside or sort of remain focused on the idea that we can have enough specialist, enough analyst, enough cyber people to take on that task. There's been a lot of discussion about the perimeter. Is the perimeter dead? Well, no, it's not really. If I'm not a technical expert at all, and you, Tyson, may have some other thoughts on that, but if you say that 80% of the malware out there is pretty well handled by basic hygiene, then there's room for the traditional approaches to defending the realm, defending the network. But we're at that stage, though, where the level of sophistication involving those hacking collectives or those individuals, those state-sponsored organizations, those proxies and others are operating at, I think it does it does, in fact, behoove us to get to a new level of gamemanship around this. And defending, therefore, takes on a whole bunch of different new approaches. Machine-to-machine learning will be a very big part of that. Advanced analytics will be another big aspect around getting at the infamous dwell time, where up to about 6 months ago, predators could exist on anybody's network up to about 229 days. We've brought that dwell time down to perhaps 30 or so days, but that has to get down to almost real time. In other words, shortly after the perpetrator has entered the network, somebody's going to discover it, and we're also going to have a plan to deal with it and defend it more proactively. So I think that's part of the new mix on the defense side. But we're also going to have to think about the recognition that if we're up against such a sophisticated set of threat actors, if increasingly we're going to be facing the realities of hybrid warfare, if we understand that there's been now collusion amongst organized criminal groups who use profit as the main motivator, but who have access to some of the greatest techniques and the best tradecraft and technologies to achieve their objectives, because they're also acting in the national interest of country X, Y, or Z, then we're up against a very, very different adversary. This is no longer just about script kiddies. It's no longer just about a small little collective of threat actors who have a criminal motive, pure and simple. This is around the complexity and the collusion of interests. And of course, their ability to operate in permissive environments that exist almost all over the world. So with that in mind, then, we have companies that say, well, we have these kind of threat actors who are targeting our IP, they're targeting our financial assets, they're undermining our economy, and we have a feeling that in some ways government's either unwilling or incapable of meeting that objective or meeting that threat or those risks and helping us, then we're left to perhaps our own forms of deterrence and defense, and that leads us down to the issue of deploying active measures, deploying active cyber defense. In a world of ACD, and in a world where most of those type of abilities are easily acquired either as a managed service or trained or acquired or built in-house, we're up with a number of policy gaps. How do you constrain that? How do you control that? What happens when somebody leaves their own network and goes halfway around the world to disrupt or maybe to steal back their own data or perhaps to punish that offender? The number of knock-on effects are almost incalculable, and I don't think we're there yet intellectually, or certainly not from a policy perspective, to manage those issues. And we're also kind of left behind, I think, in this country on the defense side, too, in terms of being national defense. We still rely quite often on the traditional perspective of what national security, national defense is. In a world where the United States has already moved to separate the piece around cyber command into one, an offensive military tool, and secondly, an ongoing intelligence collection piece. So cyber command becomes a very traditional military tool, and then the intelligence collection piece will remain within the NSA. That discussion is certainly not happening in this country, and it's happening in, apparently, according to one U.S. Assistant Secretary of Defense, in approximately 5 dozen countries around the world, where they are actively planning to acquire the tools and the capability to use hybrid warfare or to undermine or take out a potential adversary or a potential, in a heightened moment of anxiety, tension, or conflict, to take out the enemy's critical infrastructure. So we're finding ourselves in a very, very different reality at the end of 2016 as we move into the new age of 2017 and beyond. So I'll finish off with that thought, is that I think in some ways I'm rather more hopeful. I think we've come around to understanding a lot more as Canadians as to what is at risk. We understand that we're not sitting on the sidelines. We can't just duck and take cover. We are part of this globalized environment. Canadian businesses, Canadian diplomats, Canadian tourists, Canadian travelers touch every part of the world, from the time they're sitting in their home planning their trip or planning their next business venture to the time they arrive on site. We are part of that game. We are heavily targeted because we do we are the repository of some of the best technology, and we have some of the highest classified assets, and we have one of the best standards of living in the world, involving a number of Canadian companies who are often solicited to contribute to part of the solution set that we're talking about today. So anyhow, good news on that part, but we have a lot of work to do around the policy front, and we need to really get our minds around the idea that this is here to stay, and it's going to get worse before it gets much better.
We've recently witnessed cyber exploitation of political institutions, foreign influence, purposeful interference of the democratic process. And we've seen the role of social media played in the propagation and amplification of false news, clickbait, pseudoscience, and propaganda. So the mother of all questions is, what are the potential ramifications of the U.S. election on Canada and global security and privacy?
Over to you, Dick.
Gee, thanks.
As you say, that's a good question. Well, I think for one thing, we're going to have to come to grips with the fact that this is not the only time this is going to happen. And secondly, I think we need to come to grips with whether or not what has been reported, in particular on the extent of possible involvement from the outside, is accurate or not. You know, a lot of comment has been made over the course of the U.S. presidential election in particular about how we're living in a non-fact-based society. And this is just one example of it. If this were the only example, I think it would be relatively simple to develop, you know, protection mechanisms, you have warnings and whatnot. But it's not the case. I'm almost more worried about the fact that you know, the four of us up here would be regarded as not particularly helpful in resolving any issue because we know something about the topics. I'm exaggerating to make my point, but so on that front, I think in a democracy, it's going to be very hard to deal with this because there's nothing more intrinsic to our way of life than elections, and the thought that somebody is mucking around with them is not good. I mean, the easiest solution is to sort of say to all electoral managers, you can't use technology. You're going to go back and you're going to require to be, you know, you're going to have to put an X. I personally don't think that's a terrible idea, but I'm over 65, so I may be a little, you know. But to come to the second part of your question, you know, what does the U.S. election mean for Canada? I certainly do not see the glass as half full. I don't think I'm Pollyannish on this, but I think those who've been predicting doom because Trump is going to become the U.S. president are being a bit unfair. And let me give you a series of reasons why I think that. For one thing, and I apologize to any politicians who may be in the room, no politician runs for office with the intention of implementing everything he says during his or her election campaign. Almost all the scholarly work on the U.S. presidency suggests that they can only affect two or three major issues, changes, in 4 years. Their system is so huge, they can't do more than two or three. I think the Democrats are going to do exactly the same thing that the Republicans did with Obama. Every time something happens that they don't like, they're going to go to the federal courts. Think at the extent to which the Republicans were able to stop Obama doing what he wanted to do. The Republicans do not have a supermajority in the Senate, and for some things they need a supermajority, and the U.S. Senate's capacity to filibuster is not inconsiderable. Running out of fingers. Sixthly, I think, Mr. Trump, one of his major promises, which probably got him a number of electoral votes in states bordering Canada and the Rust Belt, has been that he would provide them untold thousands of jobs. I think it's impossible. I mean, there are probably some economists in the room who know better than I. Undoubtedly there are. But there's a midterm election in 2 years, and if he cannot start to deliver on some of his promises, and I think some of them are simply not doable, the Democrats may regain control of the House and the Senate, certainly of the Senate. So, plus, you know, you factor in a whole bunch of other things, including the fact that one of the reasons the Republicans acted as one unit when Obama was president is because they hated Obama and what he was trying to do.
that unifying force is going to be gone. A lot of members of the U.S. House of Representatives fundamentally disagree with the idea of more spending. And this is one of Mr. Trump's major campaign promises. So I think, both in respect of Canada and more generally, we've got to sort of, you know, take a deep breath. The U.S. system is built on the premise of checks and balances, and is Mr. Trump going to cause us grief, particularly in the area where he's commander-in-chief and can operate abroad? I suspect so, but he's already backed off on a whole area, bunch of areas. The one area where I think it's going to be tough for Canada is Mr. Trudeau and his government really had a meeting of minds with Mr. Obama's White House, and boy, that's gone. I don't care how fleet of foot Mr. Trudeau is and his camp and his ministers are, they are in a different, you know, wavelength. And we're going to have to work very hard, I think, in Canada collectively at all levels to find a way to maintain our basic positions and our basic values without unnecessarily irritating them. In fact, I was talking to Ray Hinault before the thing. You know, if our defense review comes out without a couple $1 billion being added to the defense budget, it's going to be regarded as a farce, and it will significantly irritate the Americans and a significant number of our European allies. So just something as discreet, as concrete as that. We're going to have to start thinking more and more about the effect of our decisions on our relations with the U.S., which is not to say that I'm suggesting that we should become a U.S. colony. We just have to do so more en pleine connaissance de cause, as we say in French. And it's not something that we always do as effectively as we can. Long answer to short question. I'm sorry.
Yeah, just a couple of quick thoughts on it, too. I think from the cybersecurity business, I think Tyson has some better insight, though, is changes in immigration policy in the U.S. could really affect technology or high-tech sector considerably. I think there's also this sense that Trump does not trust the intelligence community, and of course we'll see who finally gets appointed, but some of his first appointments so far indicates that he's definitely putting in some contrarians and putting some people who are a little bit more on the radical edge of all that. Will that mean that we'll see less money going into those areas? Absolutely not. But I'm not sure we're going to get some very sound policy pieces or some very well thought out activities on behalf of the intelligence community. So whether it's that question of going to do unconstitutional things, such as waterboarding or mistreatment of people to a point where they are tortured, and going back to renditions, that would be extremely problematic. And of course, it puts allies like Canada in a difficult position as well. So we could go back to the days that Dick knows very well, that it's difficult dealing with some allies that you have a lot in common, but perhaps there are some disagreements over where the priority threat is and how you're going to prosecute that threat. And that, to me, could be problematic for us.
What is the role of industry and government in protecting industry from state-sponsored espionage and attack?
Well, if I started with that one, I would not counsel industry to expect the government to do their job for them in protecting their information assets. Physical assets, perhaps, but information assets. First of all, to expose yourself to somebody else's protection is going to also involve you giving them an understanding of where your vulnerabilities are and what your risks are and where your soft spots are at any given time. And most private sector organizations don't want to do that because that type of information tends to leak out, which is why for a long time, the outsourcing of security was delayed because it took a long time for security vendors to reach a level of operational maturity where they could give someone like a retailer or a hospitality industry enough confidence in their services that they wouldn't necessarily be leaking that intelligence out to their competition. And I don't feel when it comes to things like perimeter security, that's probably not something they're going to look to the government to provide. Even intelligence in this area is fraught. And there's so many sources available in the private sector that I can't really see the government keeping pace with the private sector to the extent that they'd be able to provide a service that was going to be entirely meaningful. Hard words for this audience, I know, but...
Okay. Can I add a thought?
Absolutely.
I mean, I agree with what's being said, but there are a bunch of things that the government, I think, can do without actually providing the service that you're talking about. They can provide tax benefits. They can facilitate the exchange of classified information to the private sector. It's something in this country we seem to have a bugaboo about. The Brits and the Americans share a lot of classified information with the private sector after they've been security cleared, and it's made it much easier, you know, for them to deal with the cyber threat. There are a whole bunch of things like that that I would argue that governments can do, although I'm entirely in agreement with Tyson. You cannot expect the government to do the basic job of Canadian companies and Canadian industry. You might encourage them to group in you know, sectors of activity. There are a whole bunch of things you can do. The last thing we need to do is to have the taxpayer make sure that companies X, Y, and Z have great cyber defenses. I don't think the public will put up with it, aside from anything else.
I'm intrigued by this sort of newest development in the cyber world, because one of the things that struck me so much about the difficulties we have in cybersecurity is we are so totally cyber dependent. And we didn't factor in security at the beginning of when this was happening, and as a result, it's 1,000 times more difficult now to try to implement cybersecurity issues in relation to what is the reality today. And so if the Internet of Things is a new sort of variation on that, is that particular technology something that is susceptible to establishing standards and rules? I mean, my view is that's why God invented lawyers, was to make rules, okay? they need to be informed by people who are both in industry and in the security sector. And so I'm just curious, as we go down this, frankly, in my view, somewhat crazy world of the Internet of Things and everything being connected, is the technology that's involved susceptible to, you know, we say, okay, you got to do this, 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 and this, and you can't do this, this, and this, because, frankly, just being cheap and efficient isn't good enough.
So it sounds like your question is, should we bother with standards? Why bother? And in the area of the IoT, because these things are made fast and cheap, they also burn out quickly and they get replaced very quickly. So you're going to see, much like mobile phones, a lot of IoT devices will have 2 to 4 year lifespans and then they'll stop working and you'll replace them. So the opportunity is that the IoT as an infrastructure will be refreshed quite rapidly in many cases, and being able to get into this life cycle, the security by design, into the life cycle. It's not going to address everything all at once, but it will start to make a difference the longer these standards and guidelines come into play. The Canadian Standards Association has got standards for fire safety, for all kinds of electronic things. I have to imagine back in the 1920s, there were a lot of houses burning down because of space heaters that ran on electricity. That doesn't happen very much anymore. Hopefully we can address this in less than 90 years, but that's going to happen. The other part that I would say is that the whole notion of fast and cheap in the endpoints of IoTs is going to persist for quite a while, and there will be manufacturers that game the system and claim compliance when they're not really compliant. And in the end, the networks that we rely on, telecom networks, enterprise networks, home networks, are going to have to get smarter and more security aware, because networks for the most part right now are pretty flat, pretty dumb. A packet comes off your device, it leaves your home gateway or your office gateway, often unfiltered, and it's only enterprises and data centers that might have a baseline level of security in them. I don't want to get into it now, but we're seeing things like the advent of network function virtualization or flexible networks and software-defined networking that provide opportunities for smarter networks with more security in them that can segregate and monitor the IoT in a way that can mitigate some of the shortcomings of these devices that are on the network now and it can continue to pour onto the networks for the foreseeable future until some type of standard starts to bite in their management of data. Areas like in-field provisioning and patching, which really doesn't happen in the IoT for the most part, right down to the use of cryptographic systems and algorithms. I mean, there's a lot of work to be done, and the network can help make up for some of it until the standards start to catch.
Yeah, just a quick add-on, because I want to really reinforce or echo your point as well about standards. It's not too late, and it's absolutely necessary. Gone should be the days that, unfortunately, consumers are left with a new paradigm. Years ago, you bought something, and it came with a performance guarantee. Now, conversely, you're enticed to click and absolve the company, whether it's the service provider, the software provider, of any liability, and that has to end. So it's time for more of a Secure Canada approach, where we have standards that are set by government, must be met, hopefully with not too much duplicity, as in diesel emissions and others, and there's obviously verification, validation of all that. But also we have to look at a new position where if you want to do business with government, you have to hit that standard. And as it's been floating out in the U.S. a lot more, especially in the financial sector, there's been a great underlying theme around if you're a top tier or tier one bank, you will have to hit this. And that's everything from demonstrating governance to recuperating after a expected event in your sector. So I think that's where Canada's going to have to be, and back to Dick's point around, perhaps if there's a place where we're going to get whacked by the new administration, it'll be falling short on defense, and it'll be falling shy, I think, on our cyber security.
We often assume that security is a public good. In French, we talk about sécurité publique. Is cybersecurity a public good, or is it a private good? It seems to me how we understand that has major implications for how we provide it. And if so, there's a knock-on question, which is, what do we do about the digital divide? Because one of the interesting contradictions, it seems to me, is that much of how we provide cybersecurity actually widens the digital divide, both within our own societies and across the globe. And it's that widening of the digital divide that, in part, contributes to some of the populist movements and some of the political phenomena that we see that then fundamentally undermines the democratic values that we cherish. And so do we need to rethink also how we provide some mechanisms of security in the 21st century in order to safeguard the same values that we're trying to protect with the mechanisms that in themselves, in their feedback loops, then undermine our own way of life?
I can start off with a quick analogy. I was just thinking about it as you're saying it. Well, I just drove up this morning from from Toronto, took the 407. The 407, anybody's aware of that area, is the paid highway. You have a toll, and it's collected electronically and so on. That's a little bit of a reflection of, why was that built? Well, for a number of reasons, partially increasingly the pressures around commuting and commuter traffic and highway safety and a number of other things. That's a public-private partnership. And if you look at the bandwidth on the internet and you look at the way we've managed, in other words, if you do believe that there is severe income inequality, as I think most people do, and I think they're voting with their ballots, they've done so in the United States, we'll probably see the same sort of phenomena in Europe, is that if we fail on that mission, that we're going to end up seeing a third internet, and that internet will be a very private. It'll be for the 1%. It'll be ultimately secure, and it's going to serve a very small niche. And I don't think anybody wants to see that evolve. So I think we have to think this through, and we have to be far more proactive. As I said in my comments, it is time for governments at all levels, at all three levels, to fill that void. If left solely in the private hands, they will resolve to find a solution, and none of that will be particularly equitable, I think, and not particularly useful for the mass of us who use the internet.
How do we guarantee that if the network and the infrastructure and the Internet of Things is working properly and is not penetrable, that the services that we access over that internet are what they purport to be? How can I be guaranteed that when the scanner on the 407 reads my license plate and bills me for the bill, it's billing me only for those segments that I've used and not for the next 20 people that drive past? And what is the role of government or some other standard setting agency or someone in determining that the services that we access are exactly just those services?
I'll start. Thank you for asking that question, mm-hmm. because I didn't get the follow-up on what Dave asked. In the election, there were these fake news, accusations of fake news and emails being released. And I consider that to be a form of social engineering. You're manipulating the public's opinion in a certain way. The next step in the evolution of social engineering is going to involve the Internet of Things. And it's going to involve messages being illicitly injected into your thing and getting you to think in a certain way or to do a certain thing. That's because increasingly things have got a physical interface. They've got HMI, a human-machine interface. So imagine your smart TV, and it is 4 hours before the Super Bowl game, which is the largest televised sporting event in the world. And your smart TV flashes a message that says, for safety reasons, you have to patch this device within the next 2 hours, or we're going to shut it down because of electrical fire risks. Probably 2 million people easily in North America would rush out, download that piece of software from the URL, install it on their laptop, and try and patch their TV because they don't want to miss the game. Now, what if it was your car that said do that because there's a problem with the fuel pump? Or if it was your fridge that said that it would shut itself down the next day if you didn't patch it? This type of social engineering is going to reach the internet and is going to be a major threat that will have to be addressed. How do you address that? It's going to be tough. And security of devices is going to be a big issue. But not only security of devices, it's not just the devices that are made fast and cheap. It's the cloud-based resources that support them. Every IoT device that I can think of calls back to a cloud-based service somehow. Many of these devices are being made by small companies. Some of them are being made by big companies. But regardless, a lot of these cloud-based services are poorly implemented from a security perspective. The smaller the company, the more likely they're going to be poorly implemented. Those cloud services will be the point of attack for social engineering and broadcasting these types of messages. Again, the application of standards or the availability of standards around cloud-based security can come into play. As far as government's role, I see government's role in this to be similar to what you might see in the automotive industry, which would be lowest common denominator standards around security. You know, got to have seatbelts, headlights come on in Canada. Speed limiters top out at 200 kilometers an hour or something like that. Those types of regulations that can draw on standards would certainly provide some type of useful guidance. And beyond that, the industry will need to compete on improved levels of security in their products and their brand and their reputation. Audis and BMWs have side curtain airbags, or they were the first to, but now I think you can get them as many types of cars. That's how I see this sort of playing out, and I absolutely agree that the element of social engineering is about to come to the IoT. I haven't heard much about it yet, but I did have a call from a startup 2 weeks ago, and they're going online and they're launching their business, and they just wanted to have a quick chat because they didn't know what they didn't know about security in the IoT. And I like to learn from these companies and provide them some learning in exchange. And we were talking about this very issue, and there, you know, for those of you who are security tech in the audience, their thing was they were going to a great deal of effort to put a security certificate into their endpoint device so it could authenticate to the cloud. So they knew that it was their device calling home. They put no effort and they had no authentication on the server identifying itself back to the endpoint. So that anybody could get in the middle of that communications flow with a simple DNS hack would be able to take over those devices and push whatever they wanted up to those devices, including software patches that would override whatever was on that device and permanently compromise it or brick it. So I think there's a lot to be done here, and basic guidance in standards that become regulation in government would certainly be a benefit to the industry.
Well, first of all, I think and I hope you would agree with me that the depth of knowledge, the scope of wisdom, and also the ability to eloquently put across a very difficult subject was one shared by all four of these individuals, these great people up here, including the moderator. And I would invite you to give them a round of applause for what I think is. I've had the great pleasure, of course, of attending a lot of conferences, both here at home and abroad. And I've seen a lot of panels in this Davos style of presentation that you have here today. But I can safely say that this has been one of the more fascinating and perhaps one of the best that I've seen in a long, long time, if not the best that I've seen. I've found this panel discussion to be top of the list, and so thank you for that, gentlemen. It's been absolutely wonderful. I took away a few comments just to I want to wrap it up pretty quickly here, but there were three statements that I pinged on, and the first one was everything is connected to everything else, and I think that's what this is all about. This is what the Internet of Things, everything, quantum computing, everything that comes around really starts to denote. IoT is fast and cheap. The Internet of Things is fast and cheap, and there were a number of really significant things that come out of that relatively straightforward statement that we all have to think about very significantly. And the other one that really struck me was we are far below the maturity scale of cyber. And that, to me, is a very telling comment, and one that really sort of launches the challenge, in my view, for companies that are out there dealing with cyber and dealing with everything that has to do with this evolution that we're going through and the major changes that are going to come about as time goes on. So thank you for bringing that to our attention and bringing it clearly into focus, because to me this was probably one of the more invigorating and useful discussions that I've heard, especially on cyber and the impact of the Internet and what it's starting to make in terms of changes to our everyday life. What I liked about this discussion was that we started with the threat, and Dick, thank you for laying that out so carefully and so eloquently. That was sort of the bad. The impact of technology and what the Internet of Things really represents to us, and Tyson, thank you for that. And then Ray, you really did lay out for us what automation does in this world, what cyber is going to do and what it's going to represent in the longer term. And I think what it has done, for me at least, it's sort of spelled the next discussion that we might want to have, because one of the things that was touched on very, very briefly was the whole issue of automation. What does that mean for remotely piloted vehicles? What does that mean for vehicles with artificial intelligence? We see them now. We see drones. We see things out there that have a capability. So what does that mean? How far does automation go? What's the machine, man-machine interface? And what does that do to international humanitarian law and how you apply that? The standards were talked about here, but what does that really mean? What does it mean to the laws of armed combat, ultimately, if the Internet of Things starts to impact on how business is done, and it will, already is, having an impact on how business is done in a military context? And what does that do to the ethics of the Internet of Things? So that may be a discussion for not too many lawyers on this stage, because that you know can get very deep and very involved, but I think it bears consideration in the longer term as perhaps another discussion for us to host at some point in time. So with that, thank you very much, gentlemen. It's been an intriguing afternoon, one that I've truly enjoyed. I want to offer my congratulations to the organizer, of course, Dave, and all the folks that helped you out at ADGA Group, but also all the volunteers that helped us to make this happen today, and all those who are here today, the participants, because it doesn't work without participation, and it doesn't work without the interest that you have shown us here today. Alors, mes compliments à tous pour votre présence cet après-midi. Et en plus, merci pour les questions qui ont été demandées, parce que c'était des questions de profondeur. So thank you for that depth that you've also brought to this whole thing. I look forward. I know that our CEO, Françoise Gagnon, John Jarvis, who I know is in the room now, who's our Chief Operating Officer, and our President, JP Lachance, all look forward to the opportunity to do this again. Thank you for hosting this session this afternoon. Thank you all.